Okay, lecture 5 of the final element method in engineering. Today we are going to talk about beams. And the beam element is very, 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 very good. It's the favorite of structural engineers. And you will see how robust the solution is and how it can be used for many, many applications. Probably the building you are sitting now, or the structure where you are living, if it's a flat building with many departments or apartments there, you will have a skeleton made of beams. Okay? Also for the truck industry, the buses that you travel in every day in your cities, or probably to go to another place, they have plenty of beams. This is the beam element, note I, note J, one line. But now we have other properties that we need to consider here. Please take a look at this while I go to collect my markers. We have the elastic modulus and the inertia moment for the beam. So, we have 2 degrees of freedom per node for the beam element alone. That is one displacement in the vertical, that we will call VI, and one rotation here, that we will call theta I. Okay, and the same for the other node. We have one vertical displacement, VJ, and then the rotation, theta G. Okay. These are the 2 degrees of freedom. So there are rotations for the bending effect and vertical displacements. Okay. This is a 2D element. I mean, we are looking at it now on the plane. But it's one dimensional element on a 2D surface. Okay. Now, in the moment of inertia, you learn in the statics that any cross section has got two moments of inertia. One, for instance, if my beam is like this, rectangular cross section, we have one in X and one moment of inertia in Y. Okay. We have to see which one of them we are using, depending on the orientation of the beam. This starts to be important from 2D models up to 3D is even more important, because we need to have, as I mentioned yesterday, a normal defining the axis, the local axis of the element. Okay? Now, let's take a look at what is the governing equation of beam theory. You already know it. We have seen it in this course, in the beginning, as Bernoulli equation. Okay? Elementary beam theory. This one, we were applying it 2 weeks ago, like this. Okay. Second derivative of the deflection with respect to x equal to the moment. And this is the formula for the stresses due to bending. Okay. We are now going to derive the equations for the stiffness matrix of the beam element using something called the direct method. And it has to do with applying unit displacement in the degrees of freedom, either one unit rotation or one unit vertical displacement to each of the nodes, and with that we recover the stiffness matrix for a beam element. Okay? That's what is done. This is from a very good book on finite elements by Mr. Cook. So, the finite element methods and applications, Cook and Plesha, I think, is the other author. Okay. From Wiley, I think. So, that's a good book if you want to continue studying the theory behind the finite elements. So, this is what is happening. We apply a unit vertical displacement while the other one is zero, and we solve the local equilibrium equations. And what do we get? Also for the rotation, we get a rotation here on this node, and then the other nodes and so on. And we get to this. This is in local coordinates, the local stiffness matrix for a beam. And you can see that there are degrees of freedom for displacement and rotation. Displacement and rotation. And then here we have something that is a vertical force, usually called the shear. And this is the moment, and I. And this is the shear force, J, and the moment, J. You remember from statics that the beams have two internal forces. One is shear force, represented by B in the diagrams, and then the M. Okay. So they are recovered here. There's also another approach to get to this formula using shape functions. This is a more formal finite element procedure. And this is the standard formula to get any stiffness matrix. What happened? It got switched off. Wait a second. These things happen. The computer is doing crazy things. Again, we connect. Sometimes technology does funny things. There we go. Let's see if something happens. There we go. There's the shape functions, four shape functions. They are polynomials of x, and they are proposed as the functions representing the field of vertical displacement and also of the rotation. Okay, and applying this formula, we should get to the same stiffness matrix, where V, the deflection, is represented by N, the shape functions, times the displacement vector. We have here the two displacements, or two for node I, and the two degrees of freedom for node J. So if we apply this, we can notice also these conditions. And it means that rigid body motion is represented by the assumed deformed shape of the beam. These are like, let me see how, consistency conditions. Okay. So for the case of the beam, the curvature of the beam is given by the second derivative of displacement with respect to x. And we apply this to the formula, we get this, where V is the derivative, second derivative of n with respect to x. And by doing all that with the shape functions that were proposed, they were polynomials of x, cubic x, and so on, we get this. These are the second derivatives of the shape functions. And following the formula, also calculating the strain energy stored in the beam element with the standard formula found in any mechanics of materials book, we get to this, and we know that this is called the stiffness matrix K. And we recover exactly the same. Now, this is the augmented beam element, but now we have some terms here that we recognize. Do you remember from where they are? This one? You remember the bar element, okay? The truss element that we saw, it had a stiffness matrix like this. Sorry. Yes or no? The very first one. So that one, still recording?
Yes.
Because now the telephone disconnected. This is the bar or truss element. If we combine the truss with the beam, we get to something called the frame element. What is the difference between the frame element and the beam element? This rigidity and the degree of freedom that it can have displacement in the U direction, not only in the vertical but also like this. You remember this was the UI and the UJ. And this is the element that most software has included in the library of finite elements, the frame element, elemento marco in Spanish, because it's got the rigidity, axial rigidity, so it's a better element than just the beam element, okay? So when you solve things using commercial software, remember that it's got this. You will also need the area, not just the inertia moment of the cross section in order to solve it, okay? Now, what happens in 3D for a beam? In 3D, there's something you need to remember. There has to be some sort of normal or vector indicating to the software how the beam is oriented, because this beam could be like this, or like this, or like that, rotated from one node to the another, and then you are defining the inertia moments for the cross section, and also the polar moment of inertia, and all that. But before that, what happens to a 2D element when we map it from the local 2D to the 3D? Well, we need to do transformation as we did with the truss element. And it's a lot of matrix algebra, so I'm not going to get into it, but you know that when you have a local, a stiffness matrix in the local system and you want to map it into something that is inclined or whatever, you need a transformation. And using matrix operations, you transform this stiffness matrix in the local system to the global one. We are going now to see an example using the local system of the beams, that is horizontal beams. Okay? Very simple ones, and probably without the axial rigidity that we just learned, without these terms. Only the beam part. Okay? This is the beam part. And these ones, in green, this is the truss element. Okay? So it's beam plus truss give us frame element. Okay? Now, let's see an example. We have two elements, two supports, one internal node, moment applied there, and also an external force P. This is a statically indeterminate problem. We cannot solve it by hand using just statics. At the very beginning of the course, you learn to solve these kind of problems using superposition. And there are other methods as well, called classical methods. But you will see how easy it is to solve it with the finite element method. Okay? Find the deflection and rotation at the center node and the reaction forces and moments at the two ends. Okay? Now, if we just use the beam element without the axial rigidity, we'll only have one reaction here, vertical, and one moment, one vertical reaction, and one moment as reaction. So we have four reactions here. And that's what we should recover using the finite element solution. Let's do it. Okay. The element stiffness matrix are like this. Okay. They are giving us no data, but only that is constant, the cross section. So the same moment of inertia for the whole beam, or the two elements. And elastic modulus E, constant for the whole beam. So the stiffness matrix for element or beam one is this. This is for the second beam, they are identical, but they change here the degrees of freedom. Beam two is connected from node two to node three. The beam one is from one, node one to node two. Okay. What is the next step? You remember from yesterday, preview. When we have local stiffness matrix, what do we do next?
Global stiffness matrix.
And that process is called the assembly of the global stiffness matrix.
Yeah.
By mapping these ones into the global one. That's the next one. And what we get is the global finite element equation. Here this overlapping. And then we have here the degrees of freedom and the vector with the standard.
Two matrix?
Yes. Only two beams to represent the whole.
Because we only have two sections.
Yeah. And since we don't have distributed loads, we can recover the exact solution using just two elements. When we have distributed loads, and this is like recipe from your grandmother, you know, recetas de la abuela. If you have distributed loads, then you need to put more elements because distributed loads are approximated to the nodes. Okay? But since we have only concentrated or punctual load and punctual moment or point moment, we don't need more nodes. These are the constraints. The reflection at node 1 and node 3 are equal to 0, and so are the rotations. Theta 1 and theta 3 are equal to 0. When we were solving the Bernoulli equation using differential equations, what we were saying? We were saying V for x equals 0 equals 0, and also the slope. You see? Similar here. But now we don't have the slope, we have the rotation and V. Somehow it's analogous, okay? Now let's do that. By doing this, what happens? How do we reduce this matrix? What do we have to do? We have to get rid of the V1. This is V1 and V1. V3. Where's the other V3? Here. And also theta 1. Where's the other theta 1? Here. And theta 3. Where is it? Here. And here. What do we get as the reduced system? Only this part. With the two unknowns of displacements. These are reaction forces. F1y, M1, F3y, and M3. And these are the external forces applied to the nodes. So the reduced system, the final element equation is this. Okay. We have two unknowns and two equations. Solving simultaneously for V2 and theta 2, we get to this. Okay. I'm not going to do it now, but you can use maxima, maple, even by hand, substitution and whatever. You get to this. This is the solution of the displacements. Okay? Now, from the global finite element equation, what is the global finite element equation? Always remember that it's the non-reduced matrix, this one. This is called the global finite element equation. From here, we can get the reaction one, multiplying this line by this vector. Also, the moment, this line, or this row, by this vector, and so on for the other two reactions. Okay? Do we do that now here? And we get to this. These are the reaction forces. The shear force or the vertical force reaction, this is the moment, and this is the other ones. Okay? The stresses are given by this formula, the axial stress in a beam, that you learn in mechanics of materials 1. If not, you can go and check here in my channel. You have a playlist of stresses in beams that I recommend to you. It's in Spanish, and I think I also have some videos in English for this topic. So check it. And the problem will be finished. We need to remember that this is the Bernoulli equation, and there are certain relationships between the shear force and the moment. What is the V? V is the derivative of the moment with respect to x, and the q is the distributed. When we have distributed loads, we need to remember this relationship. The derivative of the shear with respect to x should give us the q. There's another equation that is the same one but expressed as a fourth derivative with respect to x. And instead of having here the moment as a function, we have the loading. Okay. But it's the same Bernoulli equation now expressed in a different way. Now, we finished the first example of beam. Now we are going to deal with distributed loadings, okay, for beams. We used to represent distributed load like this. Okay. It's continuous. We don't. It's not just like a finite number of arrows. It's a load that is given as a unit of length. Okay. One way of representing this is concentrating half the load, half the area of this rectangle of the load here. What is the area? Q times L. Half is QL divided by 2, and half here. And the moment is the one given by the standard formula for a double supported beam with distributed load. This is a classic formula, another recipe from your grandmother, and this was, remember, using W L square over 12, like this. This is it, this is it. Assuming a fixed support, this is the moment produced by this load at the node. Okay? Comes from this standard formula you can find in any table of structural analysis book. Okay? Another example. Are you ready for beams? How do you think? It's easy. The only thing changing is the stiffness matrix. From springs, we had just a constant value. K minus K minus K, K for springs. Then we have EAL divided by L, 1 minus 1 minus 1, 1 for the truss element. Now for beams, it's a bit more complicated, but it's more or less the same procedure. Now, imagine this. This looks more like a nightmare for any mechanical engineering student. We represent here an elastic support. Here we have a hinge. And then we have a fixed support here. This is absolutely a statically indeterminate problem. Just with the statics, we could even solve it just for having this spring here. But you will see how natural it is solving it with the finite element method. These are the values. This is a steel beam. 210 gigapascals, the inertia moment is 2 times 10 to the minus 4 meters to the fourth. Find the deflections, rotations, and reaction forces. Okay? And we have just one external load applied here at this node with a magnitude of P, 50 kilonewtons, and the rest is a beam. Let's see how it behaves. Okay? We are combining elements now. It's not just a beam. We have a spring element. You need to remember the stiffness matrix of the spring. How was it? Two videos back to this series, you will find video of the spring elements. But just for as a reminder, this is the stiffness matrix of the spring element. And we call it element number 5. Why? Probably we will use two nodes to represent each beam. Now, what are the degrees of freedom? Vertical at node 3 and vertical at node 4. Okay? The beam has a rudder or hinge support at node 2 and a spring support at node 3. We are going to use two beam elements and one spring element to solve this problem. Okay? I don't know why I say K5 here. We get this, and look, here we have the K, and the K, and the K prime. Why is it K prime and not K? Because we have this value here, so it's just like a change of variable. So that when we multiply this by this, we recover K. Okay. This outside times this give us K at the end of the day. It's just a funny thing that the person who prepared this example did, don't worry. But we are adding here the stiffness of the spring. We have finally four nodes, but one only has 1 degree of freedom in the vertical. It doesn't have rotation. Springs, at least this spring, cannot take rotation. Then node one has 2 degrees of freedom, vertical displacement and rotation, and the same for node two and node three. Vertical displacement and rotation, vertical displacement and rotation. But node four, where it is the second end of the spring, we only have vertical displacement. This one has, this node has to have rotation because there's a beam element connected there. But notice the other one, this is only vertical displacement. So what is the solution of this? This is the finite element equation in global system. What are the boundary conditions now?
V1
and theta 1 equals 0. V2, the vertical displacement, where is the hinge, is equal to 0. And V4, where the spring is connected to the ground, is also equal to 0. We reduce the matrix and we get this system with 3 unknowns, 3 equations. Solving this, we substitute the data and we end up with the solution. This is the solution in symbolical way. Substituting the values, we get this. Now the rotations are in radians. If you are going to solve this by hand or in Excel, you don't need to put your calculator in radians because we are just making operations. There are no sines or cosines here. But just remember that thetas are given in radians and the v's in meters. Okay? With this displacement and also the boundary conditions, we recover the reaction forces using the finite element global equation. Okay? And therefore, these are the reactions. Vertical one here, 60, negative, meaning going down, and negative going clockwise, the moment. As the same here, this is positive. And the force in the spring is given by this, or the reaction here. The standard force of 50 kilonewtons. If I add together all the forces, I should recover what? 0. Okay. Is it it? I have minus 59.78 plus this one, minus this one, plus this one should give me 0. Okay. Questions? No?
Whether the boundary conditions are for shear forces?
The displacements, yes. Vertical displacement, when we say V, mm-hmm. that V is directly related to shear forces, yes, in the stiffness matrix.
So?
And rotations are related to moments.
Okay.
This is different from Bernoulli equation. Here, in the boundary conditions, we are checking rotations. Because we get thetas in the stiffness matrix. Whereas in Bernoulli equation, we had V prime, was the slope of the deflection. It's a bit different.
Okay.
But they are based on the same differential equation, the solution. Okay?
But then, if we always have support, the V will be always equal to 0. Because we have 0 at 1, at 2, and at 4, right?
Yes, that's what we did. Look. V 1, 2, and 4 equals 0, because we go to the model. The vertical displacement node 1 is 0, here is also 0, and here is 0, the vertical displacement. Okay. The rotation here is 0, but not here. Here it can rotate. This is a hinge. And also here it can rotate.
Okay.
There we go. Now, just to close the topic on beam element and frame element, remember that when we have solved this problem only using beams, or the beam part of the stiffness matrix, but if we include the axial rigidity, EA divided by L, we are adding the truss element to the beam, we get something called the frame element. And it allows to solve something like this. This is a frame, okay? Marco rigido, rigid frame. And with this, we get axial load to design this column and so on, okay? The combination of bar and simple beam elements is called the frame element, and the stiffness matrix is augmented. We have now in the local system the displacement in the direction U, not just vertical but horizontal in the local system, and this is the same stiffness matrix. Okay. Now we're ready for an example activity here, and I will finish here the introduction of the beam element. As you can see, in the local system is no big deal. The problem is when we have an incline, and solving them by hand requires a lot of transformation. But it's not the point to make you suffer with matrix operation. There are plenty of software, even open source, there to solve beam elements. Even an application for the phone. Here, I think there's something called A-beam. I will write it here. And what it's solving is something like this, numerically. A-beam, and I think there's A-beam light that is free, okay? And it's also for the iPhone. Usually there are no apps for iPhone that are free, but I saw this one. I saw that it's got more than 4 stars, should be good, and I'm not getting any money when recommending you this. Yes, I'm telling you that the method is so flexible that it's now easy to program it even for mobile phones. Maybe you'd think and take this for granted, but when I was your age, and I'm not so old, there were no mobile phones. I mean, no student had a phone, a cell phone. That was like part of the futuristic imagination of some people in sci-fiction movies. And maybe just 3 years after I graduated, the mobile phones were available. But they were only made to make phone calls and send text messages. Now you have, if somebody told me at that time you were going to solve this kind of structures using your phone, I would say, these guys smoke something strange. But now it is the case. So let us use our mobile phones not just to be left with the double blue arrows in seen by your girlfriend, but use it for something more engineering or practical. Oops. Okay, I see you in the next lecture. This is the beam and this is the frame element. Okay, thank you.